I have made plenty of 3D printers before, or to be exact, but in my previous attempt, I said this.
This is made from Lego and 3D pen, so you won't be getting it any better than this.
And I took that personally. So, a quick recap. I made my first 3D printer, or actually more of a 2D printer, 6 years ago, when I looked like this. But this was genuinely terrible. The whole thing moved around and it could either print a square or a ladder, for some reason. So a few weeks later, I sat down with my dad to build an actual 3D printer, which I then programmed to print little houses. But this was not enough. So a couple of months later, I wrote my first Python code so that I could print anything, just the same way any 3D printer could. And it was still bad, and the code contained major mistakes. But hey, that's okay. So finally, 2 years later, I wanted to make things right. I built another 3D printer and fixed some of the fatal mistakes in the previous code, and the results spoke for themselves. Now the prints actually resembled the 3D models. However, to say that you won't be getting it any better than this...
So you won't be getting it any better than this...
...is a bit of a stretch. Which brings us onto today. So for the ultimate 3D printer, I'm going back to running the code directly on the Mindstorms brick, making it a standalone device. And for the printing bed, I want to use a 16x16 base plate. I'm actually going to cover it with a little different plate. But it's all bent and sticky and I want a new one. This is a sample tile of the floor in this room, and I'm going to cut out a nice 16x16 plate, which we will use as the printing bed. So let's cut it out. So how big is this plate? Exactly 5 inches. That is so much nicer than the centimeter variant. 12.8 centimeters, or exactly 5 inches. This is the first time I'm going to use inches. Pencil. Okay, look at this. I'm going to make a pencil appear out of thin air. There it is. Yeah. In theory, this is exactly a base plate. This is not a very sharp knife. It's okay. And now this breaks off. Should it fit within this? And it does. Okay, now that we have our beautifully cut new printing bed, let's put it in a frame and make the y-axis. So this is the mechanism for the y-axis, and what makes it better than the previous 3D printer is that it uses these screw pieces, which makes for a very smooth linear movement, instead of these gear X that the previous 3D printer used. Inside of this, we can place our printing bed like so. So let's put a case around it and put a motor on there to see how it moves. Okay, so let's grab a motor and some beams. Okay, put that on there. I always like to have this like gray border at the bottom. I don't know, it just makes it stand out from the ground or something. And that is our y-axis. Okay, but this is still quite difficult to turn, so I think we're gonna do a little gear reduction. So I also want to make sure that it doesn't move from side to side, so we're going to add something to keep it in place. Like this, so now we cannot move it side to side anymore. So the next upgrade we're going to add to this printer is this touch sensor, so that we can automatically find the position of the bed. So let's add it on the back. Like so, because now it touches. And finally, let's add the motor, completing the y-axis. This is very smooth. So now that we have the y-axis, I think this is a great time to start working on the x-axis. For the x-axis, we need a 3D pen to be connected to it. But this is the pen that I used for the previous 3D printer, but it's not really that great. So I bought a new pen. And this one should hopefully be a lot better. It's also quite square, which is nice, I guess, for the Lego compatibility. So let's see if we can create a mechanism to move this pen around. I got straight to work trying to find the exact Lego pieces that fit the 3D pen perfectly. And eventually, I did end up finding something that I'm actually quite proud of. So this is what I came up with. It is by far the most compact 3D printer head I've ever designed. But we have these familiar screw pieces on the side for a very smooth movement, and we have it on both sides actually, so that we have an extra stable mechanism, as you can see. And to control the 3D pen, I have this green mechanism here on the side, There's a very tiny rotating mechanism in there that pushes the extruder button on the 3D pen. All of this fits basically within as small of a footprint you can get. So I'm really proud of this mechanism. I actually did end up changing it a little bit because of some problems, but the main idea remains the same and the X-axis works just fine. So I got the Y-axis done, as you can see in this clip, and it is way smoother than my previous 3D printer, so I love it. But this motor is kind of blocking like any mechanism that is over here, so for the Z-axis I might go back to what I did for my previous 3D printer. So instead of having the motor on here, I will have it on here. This is where I really just got to work and stayed at work. I kept building for hours and hours on end until the Z-axis was finally in a state that I liked. So this rather white machine is the new 3D printer, pretty much assembled, but there's still a few things that we need to do before it's actually done. For one, I already added the touch sensors for the X and Y axis, but we still need to add one for the Z axis. So let's do that right now. So now all of the motors and sensors are on the machine, but one thing we still need to do before this machine is actually done is add this massive spool on top of the machine somewhere so that we can feed the filament into the 3D pen. So I added the spool holder onto the 3D printer. At first I added these cross beams across the top so that it is a lot sturdier. And also for some reason these Lego tires fit perfectly within this spool, so it's a very smooth rotating spool, which is amazing. So now we basically have only one thing left to do until this 3D printer is complete, which is adding on the computer and the wires. And there it is. After, well, let's just say a significant amount of clicking Lego bricks together, the hardware is finally complete. I love the way it looks. It is kind of similar to the previous design, but way sturdier and way smoother. But as we all know, a fancy machine like this is just a fancy paperweight without the code to run it. And if you remember my previous attempt,
able to print everything, but with a lot of flaws in the code, still having to do a lot of things manually, and being very inaccurate.
Let's just say there was plenty of eyeballing and hoping for the best. This time though, I want to do it properly. First up, usability. I used to have to change the code every single time I wanted to print a different file, which was very annoying to do, and one of the reasons why I only printed Pikachu for my previous 3D printer. This time though, I want to print more. How are we going to do that? Well, step one, a file selector. I know, nice, chapters, step one. That is, yeah. Now I can just load a bunch of G-code files onto the brick and pick the one I want to print right here. Like, you know, an actual 3D printer. Revolutionary, I know. Step two, precision. I know this is kind of a weird shot, but I tried to be creative here, okay? Just bear with me. A big problem was that the printer had absolutely no idea where it was when it started. You had to manually set the home position and then it just kinda went for it. But this time, auto-homing. Before every print, the X, Y, and Z axes automatically move until they hit the touch sensors. This tells the printer exactly where its zero point is. And that is all very nice, but what about step three? Well, this is all behind the scenes, because the code is completely new. I structured it properly this time, and the code is now modular. And very importantly, I swapped out the old "that looks about right" measurement system for actual calculations based on motor degrees and gear ratios, you know, math. It turns out it's actually quite useful. Oh, and bonus step! While it's working its magic, you get this nice little progress percentage. It tells you exactly how far along the print is. A nice little bonus step. Yeah, I know. So, we've got a user-friendly file system, precise auto-homing, cleaner code, and actual math. I know. Which, when you put it all together in the best LEGO chassis like this, makes it the world's best LEGO 3D printer. And I'm not even kidding. Is it really better than every other LEGO 3D printer around the world? Well, there is really only one way to find out, is there? That's Sprint's Pikachu version 3.0. I am very happy with the end result. It is so much more detailed than the previous model. You can make out the eyes, the tail is actually the correct size, and you can distinguish the individual surfaces of the low poly model. All things the previous model didn't have. Also, I won't even bother comparing it to the previous model, as they are just way different. And although this small Pikachu is great for comparison, I think this printer can take on more. So let's take it up a notch by making it bigger, for example. I have a couple of prints lined up for you, including a multi-part print. Enjoy! So there is actually one advantage to creating a 3D printer using a 3D pen, which is that you can easily print the model in multiple bigger parts, after which you can use the very same 3D pen to fuse the parts together, just like this Eiffel Tower.
That is beautiful.
Besides printing beautiful sculptures, it can also be used to print functional parts. I have been using this Lego phone stand for years now, but now I realize, why use Lego bricks to build a phone stand, when you can use Lego bricks to build a 3D printer, which you then use to make a phone stand. So that concludes this journey. The code will be available in the description for you to try out. And while you're down there, make sure to let me know in the comments what you would like me to build next. And also, consider liking the video.